Hello and welcome to Velocity Talks. My name is Christopher Durham and I'm the president of the Velocity Institute. This is my opportunity on a weekly basis to talk to some of the leaders of the private brand, the retail-owned brand industry. Today, I'm excited to welcome Andre Lombard from Damon Design. Andre, welcome. It's great to have you.
Thanks, Chris. Thanks very much. And hope everyone's having a good day wherever they are.
Well, let's start out with, tell us a little bit about yourself. Obviously, you have an accent. So tell us about Andre and how you got to where you are.
Perfect. Thanks, Chris. Yeah, so the accent gives it away, so can't hide behind that. When I needed to answer this question, kind of thought about it, but made me realize I've been around the block a few times in the retail and creative industries, I think over 30 years now. And I've kind of been lucky enough with my experiences to work through from retail. Being in the creative industry is working everything from creating those creative ideas through to the pre-press to actually doing the printing. So understand the full creative part of that. I think a benefit to me and our partners is the experience in working in retail as well, from a young person working in retail, kind of defaulting back to that. Been lucky enough as well in Damon to work on the commercial side. So I think I have a very good sense of where our clients are coming from, the challenges they've faced, and hopefully, apply my experience in things like design thinking, creative, and the commercial side is to have fun in solving these problems that our partners are facing. With my accent, I've now joined the team in the US, amazing team here, looking forward how we drive the Damon Design business locally and internationally. But I think my experience that I've worked with retailers, suppliers, and engaging with consumers, I think in through Africa, Latin America, Europe, Asia, touched a little bit on Australia. Hopefully we'll bring that through here in the US market, which I think is definitely leading private brands. So excited on the next journey for me here with Damon Design in the US.
So where are you actually living? Connecticut?
Connecticut, yeah. Based in Connecticut, East Coast. The weather's a little bit of a challenge to get used to.
A little cold.
Yeah. Coming from Africa, it's in a bit of adjustment. But definitely. The travel to the West Coast is sometimes a bit challenged. So, maybe situated centrally is probably not a bad thing for the long term, but loving it here on the East Coast.
So working in Africa, you worked on pick and pay and some of that stuff?
Yeah, pick and pay, worked with, just before I left Africa, with Tunisia, some of the more, rural African countries, which is interesting because you're working with clients who with a private brand mindset, really want to make a difference for those low income users, working with very little revenue or investment is how to extract the most out of those products and deliver something to the customer that they feel proud of. So yeah, that was interesting.
Well, I know traditionally that Damon African team's done pretty well on the Vertex Awards over the years. So.
Yeah, the little workhorse there down in Southern Africa. So,
honestly, that's one of the reasons I love the Vertex Awards, though, because we see stuff. Everybody talks about England and Canada and the U.S. Nobody talks about Tunisia or New Zealand or wherever. So you get to see all this really cool stuff.
Yeah, it is. It's I think, South Africa takes kind of inspiration from, global. So, you've got that very expressionistic European influence and creative. And then, I think we're very much aligned to the US market in South Africa more, but it is that exciting to see how everything global merges through the African market. And, Africa itself has that flair, which kind of comes into creative and packaging execution.
That's exciting. Well, so let's talk about Damon a little bit. Obviously Damon's a pretty well-known entity in this world, but, give us the elevator speech.
Yeah, 30 seconds. So, yes, I think, being part of a creative agency that falls within this Daemon and Advantage ecosystem is just, you know, is gives us an incredible privilege and insights to be able to react to this ever changing. I'm you know, the more I look at what the world is changing with private brands, you know, the growth we had last year, you know, and you know, customers allowing us to be expressive and to take private brands further, you know, being part of an agency that can tap into that knowledge and insights, the teams on the ground, engaging with the customers, you know, the strategic directions. You know, I think nationally, each retailer has different challenges and learnings, and allows us as an agency to kind of leverage those to kind of help our partners be more agile and respond quicker to our customers' demands. Definitely, you know, we have an exciting future ahead. I know, you know, the Daemon design team have been working hard in the last year to prepare. I know the Daemon teams have, you know, the retailer teams have been working hard. Strategic teams have been working hard to set us up for, I think, very big changes in private label in the next couple of years. I think it's excelling more than it's probably ever has. So we need to all be ready for that.
It's exciting. So your team, you have a team in Connecticut, you have a team in Lisbon, you have in a bunch of places around the world, as well as that on site with retailers as well, right?
Yes. So yeah, I think very much the team in Lisbon is very much, and Latin America are very much based like we are, you know, from a central point of view, and, you know, saying that loosely because we remote now, but, you know, then supporting the retailers in South Africa, we do have an on-site team with Pick and Pay, but over the last 2 years, we've developed a central team to support, you know, all other retailers that might want a more hybrid approach to go. You know, we might have a designer on site, but with the execution arm sitting in the back, helping us create more efficiencies. And similar with our Asian teams in Japan and China as well.
Yep.
Is, you know, I think we have a good balance between on-site and hybrid, which allows us to kind of, you know, retailers have those ebbs and flows. So investing in an on-site team is probably not the most cost-effective way of doing that, where we can allow them to probably have a dedicated person and then everything else kind of gets executed from the center.
Well, it can give you a global perspective too, versus, you know, here's my one designer sitting in the middle of America somewhere that only sees this space instead of this space, right?
Yeah, definitely. I think, you know, what we're seeing is the evolution, you know, of private brands globally are kind of taking some interesting directions. So keeping our fingers on the pulse of those is key to, you know, making sure that how retail partners react is at least we're guiding them in the right direction, making sure they don't make the errors that some other retailers have made globally, and making sure we can kind of put the best possible solution up front to make sure that, you know, they end up successful.
Well, so let's talk a little bit about the year ahead. Obviously, private brands, you know, the economy is good for private brand right now. But, you know, what do you see happening over the next 12 months?
Yeah, I think, Chris, I think with the, you know, with the challenges that we, the business have had, you know, last year, especially in the US around supply chain, you know, I think with the evolution of technology, I think everyone's been caught this year, well, end of last year with this ChatGPT and how AI is kind of coming into our you know, future is an interesting development. Mm-hmm. I think post-pandemic is you know, created an interesting customer for us to manage. I think reading an interesting article 2 weeks ago is that this Gen Z is, you know, we need to start looking at their introduction into our market. So there's a whole new dynamic, I think, coming in for the year ahead. I think, you know, the way customers are looking at engaging with brands, looking at that innovation, differentiation, I think, you know, really, and with the growth that I mentioned that we had earlier, I really think we need to get things in order to make sure that we can elevate off that platform that we've had and built on, because I think there's a lot of interesting developments coming our way.
I know, as I talk to people for the Velocity Conference coming up in May in Charlotte, the number one thing that the retailers, because I call retailers and say, hey, what should we be talking about? What would you like the content to be, kind of thing? And the number one thing hasn't been ChatGPT. It hasn't been global sourcing or supply chain. It's been social media, and specifically TikTok. So yeah. They're like, I see all of this happening and I feel like we should be doing something, but I don't know what.
I think there's so much being thrown at our retail partners that, you know, I think the best that we could do is to kind of quieten down the noise and extract those big value added, you know, initiatives to go, this is where you need to stay focused. This is where you need to go, because I think it's so easy to derail you, you know, and go into 10 multiple directions, which doesn't have that impact. And I think consumers are overwhelmed and just hearing a lot of things. So I think it's, you know, to make sure that we're not over communicating and over delivering on some of these initiatives is to make them impactful and deliberate.
Yeah, well, it'd be wonderful if private brand got to a place where we were over communicating.
Yeah, I think that's a good point, Chris. I think, you know, I personally, if my personal opinion is, you know, I think private brands, we've come a long way. We all know that we're in the industry, mm-hmm. and we know that we're proud of it. But I'm excited about the future, because I think we're at an inflection point where I think private brands is really now going to exceed national brands and the perception of what people perceive brands to be. You know, I think private brands in the past has really copied and, you know, as being a duplicate. I think we're going to set, you know, the future of what retail packaging, what products, what innovation is going to come out. Well, I think private brands are going to lead that more than these big national CPG brands.
Honestly, that's why the social media conversation is interesting to me, because it's, should they be doing some of it, all of it? You can debate any of that, right? What's more interesting is they're proud enough of it that they feel like they should be. That's a huge leap from where we were 10, 20 years ago, where it was stick it on shelf and we're never going to talk about it.
Absolutely. That's a very good point. Yeah. I think, you know, with Damon, I think we take it a lot for granted because we work with our retailers too, with the product development, the sourcing and things. So it's part of our DNA, but it's definitely, there is a turn in retailers finally starting to be proud of, you know, this effort that they've put in, and rightfully so, want to, you know, kind of start shouting about it.
Yeah, I mean, it's, as I looked at all of the entries this year for the Vertex Awards, and we'll start promoting more of those as we make the announcements at the conference, but there's designs in this mix of 700 plus things that are legitimately Instagrammable, that you pick up and go, this is cool, I want to show it to you.
No.
That's a long way from early 1990s to early 2000s. Here's my national brand equivalent.
Yeah. I think last year at the Velocity, I mentioned in the presentation that I did there, Chris, is that packaging's evolved from being just protecting the product, starting to have dialogue with the consumer. And what an exciting, you know, opportunity to have that, where, like you say, is, you know, this is something I want to put on Instagram. And, you know, with, you know, the AI and virtual, you know, what's it, augmented reality and things like that coming in with NFTs. And, you know, there's so much opportunity to have fun with that.
Well, so let's talk about the future a little bit. So if we like go out longer, right, 5 years, 10 years, use your crystal ball. There's no right or wrong answer here. Where do you think we'll be? What's going to happen with all of these brands that are now owned by retailers?
Yeah, it's a tough one to kind of see the future. I mean, as I said in my point earlier, I think private brands really, I think we're going to see, and I think, you know, it's our own undoing if we don't, as custodians of private brands, drive that to really, take private brands to, I think, a new level that I think we kind of ourselves internally are scratching our heads around. You know, is this possible to really take our partners' brands and to take private brands to that level? I think it is a challenge. I think, the global economic challenges that we have, consumers are still going to be price conscious. They're looking for that value driven input. But I definitely think we don't have to constrain ourselves to doing that. I think with there's a drive in sustainability, and I think the initiatives that are coming out of that from a packaging point of view, creative point of view, is I think we need to adopt that. And I know with private brands it's always a challenge. Then the commercial side of that is what retailers are able to invest, but I think as private brand custodians, that's something we've got to invest in and drive as well, is how to drive sustainability, make sure that we educate our partners on that. So I think the future is really exciting around how we, simply have fun doing that, making sure that we still add value. I think some key areas that retailers can really focus on their private brand programs going forward is to help drive that is innovation. I think, but I think it's not a copy innovation. I think it's pure innovation, that what is that future look like that we just, the main CPG brands aren't looking at. Sustainability is something that we have to, I think we have to take a conscious approach to that and commitment to going, we're going to make a stand as private brand industry. This is what we're going to stand for. And I think it's going to take more of a combined effort from all private brand stakeholders to go, this is what we're going to drive. I think you mentioned it earlier, but, strengthening the omni-channel is, what does that world look like? How do we navigate it? And I think ultimately, I think with the growth in private brands, where it's going to be is securing that supply chain. I think we've got a sense of that last year. And I think going forward is definitely all these combined is, I think, through partnerships. I think, the creative landscape in private brand packaging design is very competitive, and we're all trying to kind of compete and, fight for the same space on shelf. But I think more collaboration for the future, more partnerships, joint ventures, I think is the best way to go for private brand.
I think you're right. I mean, we're doing a virtual event here in April, so I'll plug it while we're talking about innovation, right? So it's free. Come to a 2-hour free event on virtual innovation. We're actually getting ready to field a bunch of industry research, so you'll see it come across your desk. Answer all the questions, because we're talking about innovation, and we'll be presenting it at the summit. So April 18th. But it's an exciting conversation to have of, do you have a strategy around your innovation? And then how are you going to use that to differentiate you versus just what has seemed like a bit random as far as innovation? So,
yes, I think that's as private brand custodians, we have to make that decision and define that strategy. I think it's, we've always had the, since private brand started, we as an industry had this perception that we're chasing, we're trying to catch up, we're trying to stay on par, where I think we need to escalate that now. I think this is what our consumers, and if we look at the stats for last year on private brand growth, this is where our partners are telling us, go, let's go. So definitely invest in that innovation and partnerships for the future.
Well, I mean, that's, I say be bold all the time, right? Sign all my emails that way. And it's, and my statement about innovation is, you need to decide where you want to win. Because that's really why you innovate. You're not innovating to come in second place. You're innovating to win. So what do you want to be known for? How are you going to be known? Whether it be in design or packaging or product development or flavor or whatever, but choose a place to win and then invest in it and make it innovative.
Absolutely, yeah. I think that's a good point that you made there, Chris, is I think the real days of being generalists, I think you'll be swallowed up, because there's so much happening around all these kind of channels of innovation that, you know, it's clear that you've got to kind of make sure that you focus strategically on what that is and put everything behind that.
Well, and the industry's really good at national brand equivalent. That doesn't need to go away. We just need to say, we're really good at this. Now, what's the and? What's the plus, right?
Yeah.
And it's that innovative piece. For some retailers, it may be 98% national brand equivalent, 2% of innovation. For some, it might be half and half. I don't know.
Yeah. Yes, I definitely think for retailers, you know, it's tough for them because, you know, they're driven, you know, by the numbers and commercial, and it is going to take a lot of trust and risk from their side to go, we're going to expose ourselves, be vulnerable, we're going to go down and you know, I'm sure that they'll, you know, with the right strategy, will end up successfully. But yeah, it's going to be interesting.
That is absolutely for certain. So we always close up with the same five questions, a la James Lipton. If you know James Lipton from the Actors Studio, these are a bit of a play on his questions and a few others. But let's start with number one. What's your favorite word?
Favorite word, and the design teams globally that work with me well and for a long time will have a good chuckle, but the word is accretion. It basically means the gradual accumulation of additional layers. You know, when we look with private brands and whatever industry you might be in, it can be very overwhelming to look at that big picture to go, how am I going to get there? Where do I start? But, you know, accretion means just put one hand in front of the other. What's the task right in front of you? Deal with that. What's the next task? And then you're going to find yourself on the journey of success. So, yeah, big word for me is accretion.
That's an excellent word. So I assume I know the answer to this, but number two, are you more artistic or more mathematic?
It's an interesting one, Chris. You should have told me your answer first, but I think... You know, this one is a tough one for me to answer. I perceive that I probably use both. You know, I being on the working on the commercial side, you know, as a creative, have a big, you know, love for numbers and stats and Excel spreadsheets. But I think I try to use my mathematical side to understand, to get to the root problem, is to kind of unpack that. And then switch over to my creative side to have fun in solving those and trying to find that. I think Einstein had a good saying that if you want to solve a problem and you have an hour, spend 55 minutes defining the problem and then 5 minutes on solving it.
I mean, I'll tell you, I worked as a rather mediocre designer for about the first, I don't know, 10, 15 years of my career. In England, they would call it a lightweight designer, but I was okay. I was never great. But I can remember working for a creative director who said, it's about math. And he started pulling out the golden ratio and all this stuff and said, this design's okay, but let me show you if we apply math to it, what happens. And it's just that thoughtful tweaking and smart piece of it that wasn't just slapping art on the page that you're like, oh, dude.
Yeah.
You're right. You're right. Very good. So if you could share a meal with anyone, past or present, living or dead, who would it be and why?
Sure. This is probably one of the most difficult questions I've had to answer. I'm like, right, who am I inviting? You only gave me one person. So, Leonardo da Vinci has always been one of those. I think he's been one of the greatest creative thinkers of all time. How he excelled in various fields, which kind of alludes to my background, you know, from art to science to engineering and architecture. I'd love to just, you know, pick his brain around, you know, getting into that innovative, imaginative approach on how he went about solving problems. That gives me...
Well, and that's that kind of perfect, you know, math versus art kind of thing, Vitruvian Man and...
I'll let everyone know the outcome of that discussion.
Yeah, absolutely.
I'm sure there's a wealth of knowledge that I think he took with him that we could use today.
Yeah, excellent answer. Let's see, number four, what profession other than your own would you have liked to have tried?
Mine was civil engineering. I think it's part of that mathematical, seeing how elements come together is I've always, fascinated how cities and towns are kind of structured and what you don't see, how that works together to kind of bring that seamless service. So civil engineering is something I'd give a go at.
That's very cool. Finally, if you could speak to yourself at the beginning of your career, what advice would you give yourself?
Yeah, I think, I think when you start off in your career, you're like a sponge, you just absorb everything. And I think early on, the assumption is that's the way it's got to be. And that's the best way of working. So I would have kind of, the advice I would have given myself is to disrupt the status quo a lot sooner in my career than I did. I think definitely would have had a lot more fun in a lot of roles that I worked to try and do things a little bit differently, create some excitement. So yeah, I think the biggest advice, and for those, the youngsters that are kind of listening, is challenge the status quo a lot sooner than you think you're entitled to, is because I think things are changing so fast that fresh new ideas won't go unheard.
Yeah, I think that's a great piece of advice. Well, thank you very much. So we always close with, it's my show, so I get to plug some things. I got to do the commercial a little bit. As I mentioned earlier, we're doing a meetup in Florida. So if you want to come have drinks and network with us, it's just outside of Fort Lauderdale in Oakland Park, Florida, at the Funky Buddha Brewery. Real cool brewery. On March 23rd, it's absolutely free. You can go RSVP on velocityinstitute.org. And that's awesome. We have the Velocity Conference and Expo, our marquee event, coming up May 16th through the 18th here in Charlotte. Damon will be there and our sponsoring as well. And then we, of course, have our Innovation Virtual Summit, which is also free April 18th. So come spend 2 hours. It's not too long. Learn about innovation and see the results of the research we're doing there. Thank you very much, Andre.
Chris, if I can just plug as well, there's, being part of the journey with you guys as well. And for those that haven't taken part, definitely worth. So encourage everyone to be part of any one of these or all of them. So
we appreciate that, Andre. Thanks.
Perfect.